An important piece of information for any routing protocol is the metric. The term metric refers to how to measure something. For example, miles and kilometers are metrics that measure distance. OSPF uses cost as its metric. It determines that some links are better than others. Better links cost less to get a packet to its destination. Each router will run the SPF algorithm to find the best paths through the network. OSPF considers the path with the lowest cost to be the best. The best paths are then offered to the routing table. This is a pretty good system. Unfortunately, there's a problem in modern networks. But before we get to that, we need to understand how OSPF calculates a link's cost, and that is all about bandwidth. Each link has a bandwidth. For example, we have four links with bandwidths of 10 meg, 100 meg, 1 gig, and 10 gig. In OSPF terms, the higher the bandwidth, the better the link. There is also a reference bandwidth. This, by default, is 100 meg. Back in the early days of OSPF, 100 meg was considered to be a fast link. To calculate the cost of a link, OSPF divides the reference bandwidth by the link bandwidth. So, the cost of a 10 meg link would be 100 divided by 10, which is 10. The 100 meg link would be 100 divided by 100, which is a cost of 1. Now, here's where it gets interesting. The 1 gig link is 100 divided by 1000. This should be 0.1, but OSPF only uses whole numbers. So this cost turns out to be 1. The same thing happens on the 10 gig link. Can you see the problem? Modern networks have links much faster than 100 meg, but the cost of them always comes out to 1. Let's go back to the original topology now. Before, I didn't show you the bandwidths of the links, only the costs. Let's add the bandwidth now. See how the path that OSPF selected is not the best path. The best path should use the 10 gig links. But because the cost of each link is 1, the best path has a total cost of 4. This is a higher cost than the worst path, which has a cost of 2. So we need to do something about this. The solution here is changing the reference bandwidth. Let's connect to a router and see how that's done. Before we change anything, let's check the current reference bandwidth. There's no guarantee that it's at the default settings because someone else could have come along and changed it for us. So to do that, we use show IP OSPF. Here is where we see this value, and this confirms that it's 100 meg. Any of Cisco's routers and switches running iOS will use 100 meg by default. Other vendors, and even some of Cisco's data center range of switches, may have a different value. I'm now using show IP route OSPF to see only the routes that OSPF has learned. Do you remember which value is the metric? It's the second value in the square brackets. So the costs here are 2, 2, and 3. Keep that in mind, and we'll see how they change later. Now to change the reference bandwidth. We do this under the router OSPF configuration hierarchy. The command we use is auto cost reference bandwidth, then followed by our value. The value is in megabits per second. I'll enter 1 million, which is a terabit. I've chosen a really high value as it's much higher than any of our links. Now, as the router here says, this value needs to be consistent across all of our routers. We can then confirm this change with show IP OSPF. It has definitely been updated, which is very good. And looking at the routes again, we see much higher costs. So we know the change we've made has worked. If we made this change to the routers in our topology, the costs would now look like this. Big difference, right? How might this scenario change things? There are two routers at different sites connected by a 100 meg WAN link. They connect to this link with a gigabit 0/0 interfaces. Now, how will this affect OSPF? Based on the defaults, OSPF will assume that there is 1 gig of bandwidth between these sites. It has no way of knowing what the service provider's limit is. So it will base the cost on 1 gig of bandwidth. This is inaccurate, and depending on the rest of the network, it may lead to poor routing decisions. So we can tune this by telling the router the real bandwidth of the link. Under the interface, we can enter bandwidth 100. When we look at the interface again, we can see that the bandwidth has changed. Unfortunately, I set it to 100 kilobits, not 100 megabits, but you get the picture, I'm sure. I want to be clear about one thing though. The bandwidth command only supplies the router with more information. It does not change the actual bandwidth of the link. On occasion, the reference bandwidth and the bandwidth statement won't meet our needs. In a case like this, we can set the cost on an interface manually. We might see this if there's a fault on a link, and we would prefer to use a more reliable path. Or maybe it's a backup link, and we only want to use it if necessary. In cases like those, we can set the OSPF cost on the interface to be really high. This would cause some other path to be preferred. Under the interface, we can use the IP OSPF cost command. In this case, I'm setting the cost to 5,000. You can put these new skills into practice here. Work out the cost on each link, and then the path that R1 will take to each destination. Let's go back to network advertisements for a bit. We need to lock in some key concepts. We're going to configure OSPF for the topology shown here. There are two routers connected with two links. There is an extra network per router. The first thing is to get OSPF running and form an adjacency. We'll start on R1 using process ID 10. We'll also set a router ID as a matter of best practice. Next, we'll use the network command to enable OSPF on our interfaces. Notice that the wildcard mask covers both interfaces in a single command. We're telling the router to enable OSPF on any network interface with an IP that starts with 172.16.1. Here's the key point. The network command does two things. It enables OSPF on network interfaces identified by the network and wildcard mask, and it advertises any connected networks identified by the network and wildcard mask. So in this case, this means that the router enables OSPF on the two interfaces that connect to R2. They will then start sending hello messages. It also means that 172.16.10/30 and 172.16.14/30 will be advertised. That's because their network's configured on the local router. While we're here, let's add our other network, 192.168.10.0/24, into OSPF. We'll move over to R2 and repeat the process there. That's starting OSPF, setting a router ID, and adding networks. Sorry, I added the wrong network there. To remove that config, we enter the same command with a no in front. Then I'll add the right command. That looks better. The adjacency has come up. We have another network to add, of course. And to confirm, we can look at the OSPF neighbor list. Here we have one neighbor, but two neighbor relationships. We know it's the same router because of the router ID. Let's see these in the routing table. Here's the route learned from R1. Notice that there's two next hops. That's because of the two links, each with the same cost. That's equal cost multipath, or ECMP, in action. Cisco routers will allow up to 4 equal cost next hops per path in the routing table by default. If the links have different costs, then only the best one is selected. In a case like this, both the links will share the load. We can compare that to the entries in the LSDB. Notice that there's an entry for each of the two routers. There's also entries for each of the two links. The other networks, 192.168.10 and 192.168.20, are not listed here. The LSDB doesn't include these as they're not paths through to other networks. With that in mind, here's an interesting point. When we use the network command, we do two things. Enable OSPF on an interface, which includes sending and receiving hello messages, and advertise the network on that interface to other routers. What if we want to advertise a network, but we don't want an interface to send hellos? In our example, let's say we want to advertise 192.168.20.0, but we don't want that interface trying to form an adjacency with another router. In this case, we can configure this interface as a passive interface. This prevents OSPF from sending hello messages on that interface, but it still advertises it. Let's see what would happen if we configured GIG00 as a passive interface. That's the link with the 172.16.10 network. Under the router OSPF config, we use the passive interface command. Straight away, we see that our neighbor relationship over that link drops. That's because it's no longer active, so there can't be an adjacency there. It's easy to confirm this by looking at our list of neighbors. Before we had two adjacencies, but now there is only one. If we go over to the routing table, the route to 192.168.10.0 now only has one next hop. This leads to an obvious question. When would we want to use passive interfaces? Wouldn't it be better to have all possible interfaces working in OSPF? I'll leave you to think about that one. When it comes to advertising networks in any routing protocol, there is one key rule. For a router to advertise a network, it must first be in the routing table. Now, why is that a rule? Because when a router advertises a network, it's saying, "I know how to get to this location." There are two ways a router will know about a network. One, if it's connected to the router, or two, if it's learned from another source. Another source, for example, being a static route. In both cases, that network will be in the routing table. The default route, though, is a little special. It is 0000/0, and we will never have an interface with an IP like this. So how can we advertise the default route to another router? First, remember our rule. It needs to be in the routing table. There is a small exception to this, which we'll take a look at later. In this topology, the simplest option is to add a static route to R1. As we've seen in other videos, this uses the IP route command. For the next hop, we'll use 192.168.10.2. This would usually be an IP address that your internet provider would give you. When we look at the routing table, we now have a default route. Its type is static. That's step one complete. If we look over at R2, we see that this has not yet made a difference. There's no default route. Even though R1 and R2 are OSPF neighbors, R1 does not automatically share the default route. You've got to tell OSPF to share it. We do this under Router OSPF Configuration Area. Then we want to use a magical command, Default Information Originate. This command redistributes the default route into OSPF, allowing it to be advertised. Redistribution is taking a route from one location and placing it in another routing protocol. In this case, we have a static route, and we're redistributing it into OSPF. Redistribution is a much bigger topic that you'll see if you go on to the CCNP exams. For now, this is just a very small introduction. If we take a look at the routing table on R2 again, we'll see that it's got a default route. The protocol code next to it is interesting. It says O*E2. O means that it's an OSPF learned route. The star means it's a default route. And E2 means that this route was redistributed into OSPF from an external source. That is, in this case, a static route. So whenever you see E1 or E2, you know that it was redistributed into OSPF. So we know that the rule is that networks must be in the routing table to advertise them. Although I did say there was an exception. Take a look at quiz question 5. Put in a little bit of research of your own and see if you can work out how it's done. For today's lab, you're going to optimize OSPF. All the routers are working, but they could be better. You can take the skills you've gained over the last few videos and work through it. I know you can do it. We've covered OSPF pretty well now. In the next video, we're going to get started with quality of service. This is where we can prioritize different traffic types. I hope to see you there.